Right, let's check some technicals before we start. Can anybody hear me? Hello? Can anybody say something, Kiran or Adi? You guys are muted, so. Just say something so that we know audio is working.
Hi.
All right, cool. Okay. Sweet. Okay, so we resume back to the second homework. Let's go quickly through it. Anybody have any suggestions, answers, solutions that you looked at during this week? So if you have looked at this position, you know, like this was supposed to be homework for about 2 weeks now, if you guys have any solution or anything, this is the chance to speak. No one? Hello? No one has looked at this position? That's pretty sad.
Well, I kind of did, but then again, I kind of forgot to check this, so.
Okay. Okay, so let's discuss what variations you looked at. I think we can start with that.
So, the first variation, which is probably the wrong one, which, as you said before, is king. So, I would go pawn to f4.
Okay.
And then king to b5.
Right. So, let's again...
Wait, no. King to b4, actually.
No, hang on. So, Adip, let's restate two goals, okay? So... I'll just take a pause here and restate the goals that both sides are trying to do. So what is it?
Promote the pawn and capture the opponent's pawn.
Right. So that's the thing, right? So both...
Well, technically...
We'll try to do the following two things, right? So the first is promote their own pawn. And second is stop opponent pawn. Okay. So these two principles should guide your calculation. You know, like these two principles should help you select moves for both sides. So say the variation you're considering f4. I think if black tries to move his pawn, that will not work. We can come back to that. But let's try the second principle, which is black will try to stop the white pawn, right?
Yeah, so the purpose of b4 is so if he gets near, if he continues his pawn's path, he's just going to catch up with the pawn and capture it.
Okay, so what is going to try? What does black try to do?
He's trying to stop the opponent's pawn, and then it's probably going to end up in a draw.
Okay, how will he try to stop opponent's pawn? How will black try to stop?
Well, he's going to... I did like b4.
Okay. So, can you explain to me in simple English like what you're trying to do by going to b4?
So, when he goes to b4, if he continues his pawn, he's just going to eventually... reach to e7 and just capture it.
Okay, so that's your plan. So what are you trying to do? What principle, what concept are you using?
Stop the other pawn.
A little more advanced than that.
We're just like stopping the pawn from promoting.
Okay, and what do we use? You know, like how do you know that you can stop the pawn?
So
even before you calculate the moves, you can visually see if you can
Because
or you cannot.
In three moves, because he needs four moves, they'll take up one move. So, pawn to f5, king to b4. Wait, right?
It's black to play right.
King to b4, pawn to f5, king to c5, pawn.
Hang on, Adi. I think you're getting ahead of yourself. What concept are you using to
magic
decide?
Square.
Magic square, right?
Yeah.
So always remember that, you know, like some magic square is something which will help you whether to calculate or not, right? So using a magic square, you can decide if black's king can capture or stop the white pawn, right? So that's the concept we use. So magic square tells me that black can stop the white pawn, right? So if black's king is not able to enter the magic square, then he will not be able to stop white pawn, and then calculations are not needed at that point, right? So say if the black king was on a1, do you even need to calculate a variation where black king is trying to stop the white pawn? The answer is no, because using magic squares, I know that black will never be able to enter white pawn's magic square, and you can just stop your calculations there, or at least the variation, which involves stopping the white pawn. But since black king is on a4, he can go to two squares. He can either go to b4. He can also go to b5, right? I mean, so black king goes to b5. And then if I play f5, then he goes king c6. If I play f6, king d7, f7, king e7, and I stop white pawn from promoting, right? So this ends up in a draw.
It's also kind of risky as well, because then it's going to end up in a draw.
Yeah.
Because then he cannot catch up with the black pawn, which makes white able to capture it. So it would end up in a draw.
Right.
Well, in this variation.
Yes. So white king will go after the black pawn, and then it will be a draw, right? Okay. However, which move will you pick? King b5 or king b4?
King b4?
King b4.
Oh, yeah.
And so you think this will also end in a draw, right? If I play f5, king c5, f6, king d6, f7, king d7. So this variation is a draw. However, king b4 is a mistake. Can you tell me?
Oh, wait. Oh, that makes sense. Because you may move king to b4.
Okay.
Wait, not d4.
White will play king to d4, right? So it will stop the black king from entering white pawn's magic square. Mm-hmm. So say I play king b5 now.
King to d5.
King to d5, right? So you again use the same principle. You're stopping the black king from entering white pawn's magic square. Then say I go to king a6.
Then you move to king d6. I mean, not d6. I mean, c6.
Do you really have to do that?
Mm.
Now, see, now the black king cannot enter white pawn's magic square, right? So say I play f5, and after moving f5, now my magic square is this. All right. Let's use a different arrow. Now this is my magic square. And can black king enter this magic square?
Because okay. King to b7 and then king to c8.
Okay, you play king b7, then my magic square changes after I move my pawn. Right? So you cannot enter white pawn's magic square.
Yeah, true.
That's a no. Black king can never enter white pawn's magic square. And white will promote his pawn, right? So this is winning.
Okay.
So king b4 is a mistake. Because then it gives white the chance to stop black's king from entering white pawn's magic square. White's king stops black's king from entering white pawn's magic square. Right. That's the main thing. That's the lesson here. And he repeats that principle again and again. And now for sure, black cannot enter white pawn's magic square, and that's why white is winning. Okay, so f4 and then king b5. So f4 is a mistake, actually. It's the first move. Sorry. First move f4 is a mistake, because then instead of king b4, black can play king b5. It's a good move. And now black king can safely enter white pawn's magic square. If white plays king d4 now, he's one move late, right? So he plays king d4, then black king is already on his way to the queening square, right? So ultimately black's plan is to occupy the queening square so that white pawn never promote. And this ends up in a draw. So king f4 move is not the correct solution here. So can you try to guess with that knowledge and in hindsight what white can play on the first move?
King d4,
right? So now it makes sense. Right, so white first plays king d4. This is correct move. Now there are a few variations, right? So with the first move, what is white trying to do with the first move? You know, king d4, what is white trying to do? Anyone? Kiran, you suggested the move king d4. So what is white trying to do here?
Prevent the king from getting into the pawn's magic square.
Yes, he's preventing black's king from coming to white pawn's magic square. Still, black can do two things. He can either move his pawn, right? Or, so we will come back to that variation later. But first, we'll see king b5. So now what, Kiran?
King to d5.
Now let's say I play king a6.
F4.
I play king b7.
F5.
I play king c7.
King e6.
King e6. So I play king d8.
King f8. King F7.
King F7. Okay, now I'll start pushing my pawn. So King F7, I really have to highlight that it's a good move. You're trying to control the queening square. Okay. That's good. Now what?
King G8.
G8. All right. Suppose that could work. Maybe I play king e7.
King g7.
King g7. Yeah, all right. That works. So I think king g8, king g7, that's also fine. You can be a little safer and just play f6 right now. Right. So, okay. But king g8, and if I play b4.
Or F6.
F6, B3.
F7.
F7, B2, and queen with a check, right? Yes. And K. Queen with a check, and then white wins, right? Then it stops white's black pawn from queen. So yeah, when the opponent king goes to a square from where you can queen with a check, so right, so king d8, this now works to white's advantage. So black's king is on a square from where white queen's pawn, it will be a check. So either if black's king is on any of these squares except f8, I guess, white will always queen with a check, so that works in white's favor. So yeah, white is just in time, you know, like he wins by one move. It's just in time to win. I think there are a few ways to win. So f4, so third move f4 also works. I think f4 is also a good move. There is another interesting variation here, which is king c6. I don't think king c6 will work. Yeah, f4. We'll have to do f4. Yeah, king b7 and then f5. King c7, king u6, king d8, king f7. And b5. You can even play f6 here, I'd say. Just push the pawn, right? And b4, then things go the same way. And again, you queen with the check. Yes. So white wins here. Okay. So king d4. Let's go back to the first move. So king d4, king b5, king d5, and white wins. Because white completely stops black's king from entering white pawn's magic square. However, now black can try to promote his own pawn with b5. What shall we do in that scenario?
King c3?
If you play king c3...
Oh, wait, yeah. Okay, king d3.
If you play king d3, I can play b4.
Then c2.
If you play king c2, then I'll play b3.
Then b2.
B2. Okay, b2. So white's king has stopped black's pawn. So that's a good thing, right? But can black's king stop white's pawn?
Yes.
Yes, right. So you can just say king b4, and f4, and now the magic square is this. Right, so now this is the magic square, and black's king is already in the magic square. So black's king will be able to stop the white pawn, and then it will be a draw, right? And I'll just play king c4, f5, king b5, take king e5, and then it's a draw. So that actually ends in a draw. So king d3 ends in a draw. What else? So anyone here? Oh, white should continue now.
F4.
Right, so the only other choice that white has here is to push his pawn, because moving his king doesn't really work. So F4, I play B4 now. Go on, B4. All right, guys, I think things are pretty obvious. I mean, not obvious, but there is only one way white can continue. F5, right? So white has to push his pawn. So now the thing is that this is black's magic square, is this one. Right, so this is white pawn's magic square, and can black's king enter white pawn's magic square?
No,
right? So black only has one option to push his pawn, B3.
So then maybe white could do king c3?
King c3, right. King c3.
Because then black will have to do king a3.
Mm-hmm.
And then once the white pawn queens, it will queen with the check.
Right. So that's why king c3 is an important move. So by playing king c3, what white does is that he forces the black king to occupy a bad square. A square from which white can give a check when he promotes, right? So that is white's intention. So king c3 is a good move for that reason. King a3, and then how will white continue?
F6.
F6, b2, then what?
F7. Then king c2.
If you play king c2, then I will play king a, and then white will lose here, in fact. Then black spawn queens with a check. Right? If I play F7, then black spawn queens with a check and white loses. So it now becomes minus plus.
Minus plus means black wins?
Yes. So this convention, plus and minus. So if I give plus and then minus, it means plus for white, minus for black. Minus plus means minus for white, plus for black. That means black wins. Okay. So that's a very known conventions when we write variations. Minus plus means, well, black wins. So king c2 is really not required. So b2, just play f7. Now he queens. Queen with a check.
Then queen with the check.
And so black's king can go two squares. If he goes to king a2, then what?
Then it's check and mate.
Checkmate, right?
But then if he goes to a4,
then what?
Then oh yeah, I see it. Queen a8, check.
Right.
Then forced to do King B5 and then
Queen B7 and then we get the decisive skewer and white wins, right? So white basically wins in all the variations. Right. Yeah. So let's go back to the starting position. So the first move that white plays king d4, you know, he wastes a move with his king, you know, like instead of pushing his pawn, he makes a move with his king. And that still works in his favor because if like black...
The queening square?
Yeah, so I mean, he does both the things. And like the first important thing is that he stops the black king from... he stops the black king from entering white pawn's magic square. So because of this particular maneuver of king d4, king d5, black's king will never be able to control the white pawn, right? So it will never be able to stop the white pawn. So with king d4, he achieves that. And also he has this very crucial tactic if black starts pushing his pawn. If black pushes his pawn, then push, 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 push. And now at the crucial moment, he has this fantastic maneuver, right? He has this fantastic maneuver where he forces the black king to come to a bad square. Just gonna put a diagram here. Piece, special annotation, piece path, and also a diagram. Insert diagram, yeah. And the other thing is that if black doesn't play king a3, he just cannot stop the white pawn from queen because he's already out of the white pawn's magic square. So he cannot enter this square. He cannot enter any of these squares. That's why white wins. So I'm just gonna write here. Because of this fantastic tactic, white wins. Black's king is forced to occupy a bad square, a square where white's pawn will give a check when he promotes his pawn, right? So that's the reason, that's a crucial tactic that white wins. So as I said earlier, you know, like sometimes the geometry of the chessboard works in favor of one side or the other, and you just got to know how to use that in your favor. And this is how white uses it. So in all the variations, white wins after king d4, with best play white wins. Best play from both sides. And I think this is very instructive, right? So, I mean, even though, you know, like in the starting positions, we know that it's a pawn race, so you got to push your pawn. But this position is like a very counter example on how differently you have to think, right? We can conclude this pawn race thing. Any questions? All right. So for the rest, for the remainder of this lesson, we are gonna look at an entire game the way we did a few lessons back. So white wins and all the open. So any questions on the previous position from any of you guys? Abhijit, Kiran, Adi? All right, I'm going to assume no questions. So we are just gonna you know, like add a little variety to our lesson today. Today we'll be, for the rest of the lesson, we'll be looking at a full game, mostly to the theme of this game. You know, like the lesson we are looking at is it's activity of pieces in the end game. All right, so if you look at a lot of chess books that are written by different authors, at least by substandard authors, they mostly revolve around openings and how to win in openings, how to quickly win in openings. Any book that says how to crush an opening, you know, like how to crush Sicilian, how to beat French. So if you see any book which has a title like that, run away from it. Never buy that book, because that's an indication that it's a substandard book. Because I don't think you can crush any opening. There are just things. Those books just give like very bad lines for the opponent. They assume that the opponent is a very weak player. He will play all bad moves, and then the opponent will, you know, like you will win very easily. So I highly am against books which use extreme titles. So it's very hard to win out of opening if your opponent is a strong player, right? So we are going to assume you're playing against a decent opposition. And so when you're playing against a good opposition, good opponents, good players, a game usually goes in a zigzag pattern, right? So sometimes you have a small advantage, then it's equal, then maybe you get another small advantage, maybe it drops and you have a slightly inferior position. Then again, the position increases where you have a small advantage. And the reason the game fluctuates like that is because we all are humans, and when we play a game of chess, we bring our human mistakes into the game. And having said that, it still gives us a lot of opportunity, you know, like it makes the game interesting, because the game is not just technical or mathematical after that. It's more of a fight of two styles, right? So it's one player, one style of playing against the other style of playing. And so with that, we are going to look at a game where something similar happens. White gets a small advantage out of the opening, and it quickly transitions into an endgame. And then white is left with the task of increasing, you know, like of putting pressure on the opponent and increasing his advantage. So we are going to look at a practical game, a game between two grandmasters. So both are very good players, and we'll see how these two styles, play against each other, how they try to outmaneuver each other. Okay, so with that, let's start looking at the game. We'll go past the opening phase really quickly, because as I said earlier, we are more interested in how to conduct the later part of the game than seeing how to play the openings. So this is a King's Indian defense. A legitimate opening played by black, e5. And now white takes d into e5. Black takes d into e5. So here, just a quick note, if black takes with the bishop, then it's not really a good move, because then you're putting your bishop out for risk. White can quickly gain a tempo. He's threatening to exchange his knight for the bishop, and then if black goes behind, then white can just increase the pressure with bishop g5. If knight f6, then I can just play queen d2, and white has a very good position after this. A lot of development ideas. You can go h4, h5, or even exchange the bishop, create dark square weaknesses. Okay, so I'm just going to leave it at plus equals. Sorry. So plus equals means white has a slight advantage. So bishop to e5, not a good one. Dean to e5, and then take, and white plays f4. So the idea of f4 move is that if black takes the pawn, then white develops his bishop, and he starts putting pressure on the c7 square. And he can quickly castle, and black's king is under attack. Right, so that's an idea there. So he plays f4, black develops. White develops, black develops. And now white goes knight g5. So with this move, what white is trying to do is that he's trying to swap this knight for this bishop. And once this exchange is done, the white squares in black's positions. The light squares, the f7, b7, or e6, these squares in black's position will become weak. And we'll see how white eventually uses that to his advantage. Okay, so knight at 6, bishop b2, c6, castle. So these are all standard development moves in e7. h3. Into f4, bishop into f4, knight e5, and rook d1. Now black played f6. We'll just look at a few variations. Well, what happens? So at this instant, it's a little hard for black to develop his pieces. First of all, he cannot take the c4 pawn. So if he takes bishop into c4, then he loses a piece to bishop into e5. If bishop into e5, then bishop into c4, and white is a piece. Right? He has an extra piece. If after bishop into e5, he plays bishop into e2, then bishop into g7. If he takes the rook, then again white takes the other rook, and black takes rook, white takes the bishop, and then again white is a piece. So he cannot take the pawn with his bishop, and he cannot take the pawn with his knight, because if he does that, then knight into e6, f into a6, and then again white takes the knight, and then he's a piece. So black cannot take the pawn after rook a d1. And so what else can he do? If he tries to develop his rook, it's a rook d8, and white can just take rook into d8. And if rook into d8, then I can take a pawn, and white will be a pawn. And if he takes king into d8, then white can play knight a4. And the idea is that I now want to play knight c5 and bring more pressure. Or even better, he can just take, and then play knight a4 with more pressure. It's slightly equal. Some of these variations are going to look a little strange to you. That's because these are pretty advanced variations. On both sides are pretty. Both players, white and black, are very strong players. So the deepness of their moves might be a little confusing to you at the start. So we are not going to delve into that too much. Just see how the game continues. So black played f6 here. White takes, 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 takes. And now we have reached an endgame position where white has a slight lead in development. So let's just look at this position. How do you think white should continue now?
Bishop to g4, check.
The bishop to g4. So now let's look at this position objective, right? So if you compare the pieces, right? So I think white's two rooks are better than black's two rooks. Can we say that?
Yeah.
Because they are on the open files. Then white's knight is slightly better than black's knight because this knight is on the edge of the board, right? So this knight is on the edge of the board. Whereas my knight is in the center and maybe it's ready for an action. And the bishops, I think, are probably equal, right? So I think bishops are equal because, okay, white's bishop is in the center, but it's not doing much. And then black's bishop is also not doing much. If you play bishop g4 check, and I think the idea is pretty sound, that if black plays king e7, then you can give a check, right? That can happen. But then you're exchanging your bishop for this bad knight. So this knight on the edge gets exchanged, and now black can, bring his bishop to a better square, bishop f8. Now I'm trying to bring my bishop to c5, where it will give a check to the white king. And okay, I think black has a decent position here. So bishop g4 is not really a bad move, but I don't think it's a good move either. So I'm going to put it as dubious, okay? This means dubious. Not a bad move, but not a good move either. So maybe there is something better.
So if the knight wasn't there, it could actually be checkmate.
Yeah. So if knight wasn't there, but it is, right? So we have to take the position as it is and not daydream about it, right? If it's not there, then this could happen. So we have to take the position as it is and then work from there. I'd say just take about like 5 minutes to think about this position, how you will continue from this position as white. Because this is sort of like an opportunity for white to improve his position. He already has his rooks in good position. If given the chance, black will just see if it was black's move, black will just play rook d8 and So let's see. If given the chance, if it was black's move, then black will just play rook d8 and he will, then his rook is also good. And then he can start exchanging the rooks and get, you know, like closer to equality or a draw. Right, so. But it is white's turn to play. And as we have seen, at least in endgames, that whose side to play matters. And that gives you an opportunity to gain advantage or exploit a weakness in your opponent's position. So let's try to take a look at that. Let's try to think about that. Just going to take a quick restroom break in the meantime.
I think I have a good move for white.
White to play. So let's open the session up. What do you guys think here? How should white continue? I'm gonna go one by one. Let's start with Kirill. So, again, what do you think? How do you think white should continue here?
Knight a4.
Knight a4, very interesting. Actually, you found out the move that white played in the game. Yes. So knight a4 is a very good move here.
So see, I think Abhijit was recommending bishop g4, and the idea was simple, right? So if black plays king e7, then I have this devastating rook d7, and then I take the black's bishop. However, because of the knight on h6, I can't really play bishop g4. Right? Can't really play bishop g4 because he has knight into g4. So the knight is there, it's controlling g4. So what else can we do? How else can we bring pressure? And knight a4 seems to be a very good move in terms of that. So white is immediately threatening knight c5. So if black plays, black plays rook d8, then I'm going to score check, king e7, and grab a pawn, right? So right here, it's just simply a pawn up. It's in a much better position. So knight a4, rook d8 cannot be played. So let's say he plays b6. Now what?
You play c5.
C5, right?
That's the good move because if black does not beat it, then you can checkmate.
Okay. So only one guy speaks out.
Really,
so c5, what can black play here? So white's immediate threat. White has two threats. He is planning to play bishop c4. See, g4 is not available. So I'm going to go from c4. And the other simple threat is that I just want to grab a pawn. I just want to grab this pawn, right? Using my knight and pawn. So how will black respond here? He has a few ways, right? So if he takes the pawn, then takes check. Black king has to go here, then check. He has to go here, then I take this, and then I'm piece of right. So white's position just improves dramatically if black takes white's pawn. If he defends the pawn, then I can just go check. Now this pawn is helping me give this check. And king e7, and I just take another pawn. Now pawn. And I also have two threats now. Take the pawn and also give a check and take the bishop. So white is probably winning here. Right, so he cannot even play that. If he plays b5, then I can simply do the same thing, check, king e7, and I just take this. If he takes my knight, then I give a check, and it's probably going to end up in a mate. Or maybe not mate, he plays king d8, then I can just take the bishop. And I'm a pawn up, and again, white should win here. Pawn up and much better pieces. I have good rooks, good bishop, whereas black has bad rook, bad knight, as well as bad king. So white is pretty much winning here. So c5 will just kill, will just give white a very good position after c5. White has a winning advantage after c5. So b6 really doesn't work. Black played bishop f8 in the actual game. Now what? Now how will you continue? So with knight a4, white achieved a very, very important thing, which is disconnecting the black rooks, right? So, and the bishop has gone to a bad square. But how will you proceed from here? See, if you give me a chance, I can again play b6 now, right? So if white doesn't do anything, if it's black's turn to play, white can just play b6. Yeah, black will just play b6.
And now c5 doesn't hold that. You know, like c5 is not strong anymore because then I can play b5. And now I'm covered. This square is covered by the bishop. So I can play b6 here. So after bishop f8, it's white to play. So how will you keep the pressure on black? How will you improve your position?
C5.
Just C5.
Just C5. Yes. So C5. With C5, white has definitely stopped B6. And also, if you notice, he has stopped the black bishop from developing. You know, like if, say, if black wants to develop his bishop to E7, trying to connect the rooks, he cannot do that because just one move checkmate. Right? So C5 is a very good move. It stops the black bishop from developing. It also stops the black knight from developing. If black wants to bring his knight to f7, again, I have this check, and knight f7, check, and then I get the knight. So even the black knight cannot develop. So black is forced to bring back his king to e7. So king e7, white improves his bishop to c4, and black plays rook d8. So black develops one of his rooks. White can't do much about this. However, he increases the pressure on king's side, g4. Now the idea is that I want to play g5. I want to play g5 and then push this knight back to g8. Right, so if white gets another move after g4, I'll play g5, the knight is forced to go to g8, and then you can see that all of black's pieces are on the back knight. It's a pretty bad position for black. White should actually, but it's really better. He can even just get a piece, right? Check. King here, and maybe check takes, and I'm a piece up here. It's a very, very good position. So g4. White plays g4. He's increasing the pressure. So black takes. So black is under a lot of pressure. That's why he's trying to reduce some of the pressure by exchanging pieces. So rook into d1. Rook into g1. And now, again, white is still threatening g5, right? So white is still threatening g5. If black plays knight f7, then that really doesn't work because I can just take, rook d7, check, and I get a pawn. White, again, is much better. Right, so g5 is forced by black. So this king side is pretty much set. Right. So what white does is that he opens up a second frontier. Right. So black has defended king's side. White cannot make more progress on the king side. He has done the maximum progress he can on the king side. So what can he do now? How will he break into black's position? Black's position looks bad, but now you have to break into. You have to bring your rook somewhere inside black's position so that you can start gaining some pawns and start gaining some advantage. How will you continue from here? So, as I said, the king side is pretty much blocked. White has made the maximum progress on the king side. So what he does now is tries to open up the queen side. It's b4. Idea is b5. I'm going to put some notation here. White has achieved the maximum progress on the king side with his bishop on c4 and pawn on g4, restricting the black knight on h6. So that's the highlight of the position. White now plans to open a second frontier on the queen side. To open lines for his rook. So let's highlight a few pieces in this position. The knight on h6 is bad. The rook on h8 is bad. The bishop on f8 is bad. But there is no clear-cut way for white to enter into black's position. And that's why white plays b4 with the intention of breaking through on the queen side. After this, white's after discovering this plan, white's position plays by itself. So black again plays bishop g7. He wants to exchange the rooks with rook d8. So say if I play b5, then he can just play rook d8, and it's in time for the exchange. What does white play here? Plays knight b2. Black played rook f8 here. However, the key question is what happens with this rook to d8. So this is a very critical question right here. How white should continue after black plays rook d8? But it's trying to exchange the rooks. The few things, obvious things are that if white removes his rook to e1, trying to stop, trying to avoid the exchange, then black's rook can gain activity. And I don't think this is the ideal solution here. So I think rook d8 is where we can stop our lesson today. It's a good stopping point because we can leave this as a homework for you guys. And you can work on this position and try to calculate, evaluate, build a strategy on how white should continue after this position. How you should continue his game. Whether you should exchange the rooks. And if he exchanges the rooks, then what his strategy will be after changing the rooks, how he will continue the game. And if he doesn't exchange the rooks by saying, let's say bishop d3 or knight d3, then again, how will he continue after that? And remember, like your variations, your calculations are not just about thinking about white's moves. You also have to think about how black will respond, how black will play. And that's where most of the complexity lies. The complexity lies in your opponent's defenses. If your opponent gives better defense, plays something which is unexpected, then that can complicate your variations, your ideas. So always think about what your opponent will be playing. So rook d8, let's stop our lesson here. This is homework for you guys. We will not be meeting next week. We have a break next week for sure. So you can use that time to think on this position. So white to play. how will white continue his strategy? Strategy. It's not the right spelling. After exchanging rooks. So the first question is, if he should exchange the rooks and if yes, then what will be the strategy? What should the strategy be after exchanging the rooks? Think on those two questions. I will post the notes for this lesson on the Drive folder, so you can go and take a look at this. All right. Any questions? All right. Any questions, you guys? Okay, then see you in 2 weeks, and hopefully you guys get some time to do the lessons. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Have a nice day.
Bye.
Bye.